So we have one scripture reading today. This is from Mark chapter 2, verses 23 to 28. As I told you last week, things jump around quite a bit, and so now we find Jesus, he's out in a wheat field picking grain. So it says, one Sabbath he was going through the grain fields, and as they made their way, his disciples began to pluck heads of grain. The Pharisees said to him, "Look, why are they doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath?" And he said to them, "Have you never read what David did when he and his companions were hungry and in need of food? He entered the house of God when Abiathar was high priest and ate the bread of presence, which it is not lawful for any but the priest to eat. And he gave some to his companions." Then he said to them, "The Sabbath was made for humankind and not humankind for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord, even of the Sabbath." This is the word of the Lord. So I'd like to begin today by talking about rules. Now, rules are interesting things, right? Because some of us love rules and some of us hate rules. If you love rules, probably that's because they bring order and structure to your life. Rules provide us with a sense of predictability in an often chaotic world. Am I right about that, for those of us who like rules? All right. Okay, for those of us who hate rules, we feel that rules are the very thing that restrict our freedoms. Rules are those things that basically suck the joy out of life. Am I right about that for people who dislike rules? Okay. So, I don't know where you are on the spectrum of liking or disliking rules, but I have observed one important thing, which is that your stage of life tends to dictate how you think about rules. So when you're a little kid, I have little guy, he's 4, your entire life is dictated by rules. And it's actually really important that these rules exist because you don't have enough life experience at that point to know when your actions could be harmful to your health. And so he's got all these rules that just dictate his life. Every little thing he does, there's a rule about it. And he doesn't understand why most of these are in place, but he knows ultimately he needs to follow them. So, for instance, you know, he looks at that knife on the counter and he's like, "Oh, that's really shiny and nice. That would be fun to play with, right?" So we put a little rule in place: no playing with knives. Now, did you all have that rule in your house growing up? No? Yes? Some of you did? Those of you who didn't, I'm surprised you're still here to this day. You had negligent parents if they didn't have a rule: no playing with knives. So, as we get a little older, though, those rules, which were put in place primarily to keep us safe, they begin to feel a little bit constricting. Particularly when you're a teenager, those rules that your parents impose on you, they can feel a little bit arbitrary and senseless. And the reason why this happens is because when you become a teenager, you're physically able to do a lot more than when you were a child. And that physical ability, what it leads to is this belief that those rules no longer apply to you. So if we use the example of the knife, right? When you're a teenager, I think everybody knows quite well as teenagers that a knife can cut you. And you probably even develop some physical skill with how to use a knife. But just because you know how to use a knife doesn't mean you know how to use common sense. Am I right about that? Have you ever had a conversation like this with your kids, if you've ever had teenagers? I remember saying this to my mom: "Why can't I stay out past 10 o'clock? I know that Timmy got a reckless driving ticket for going 120 miles per hour on I-90, but Timmy is still my friend, and friends stick together, Mom." Either you've said it or it's been said to you, because that's the way teenagers are, right? So it's true, their judgment, it's not the greatest, and that's why their insurance rates don't drop until they're about 25 years old, right? It takes that long for them to get their impulses under control. And for any teenagers who are in here, I want you to know I am the worst possible case scenario of why you need to make sure kids should not have driver's licenses. It literally took me 1 week from the time I got my license when I was 16 to get a reckless driving ticket. 1 week. I am the poster child for why people should not give teenagers licenses. I know, that's really upsetting. They shouldn't do it. Then as you get a little bit older, though, things begin to change even more. Because when you grow into adulthood, all of a sudden, all those rules which used to govern your life, well, in some ways, they no longer exist. As an adult, you can pretty much do whatever you want to do when you want to do it. And ironically, this is the time when people begin to value rules the most. You see, as an adult, you have a little bit more perspective on the world. And you realize that allowing people to do whatever they want to do when they want to do it, well, that leads to chaos. And so adults tend to value rules the most. And it's why we spend so much time in the court system trying to figure out which rules are right and which rules are wrong, because every single person who's an adult wants their version of the rules to be the ones that everyone else has to follow, right? Am I right about that? And this is particularly true of religious people. People who adhere to a religion believe that they know exactly how humans should be living their lives. Why do they believe this? Because they have in their possession documents, or scriptures as we call them, that tell us exactly how God wants us to live. Now, these scriptures are important because they lay out a roadmap. They're kind of like a manual that tell us exactly what the rules for morality are. But here's the thing. Not all religions agree about what those rules should be, right? And even within the same religion, there's disagreement as to which rules should take precedence over others. To use Islam as an example, not everybody who's Muslim interprets the Quran in the same way. And as is evident from all the fighting in the Middle East, many of those people are willing to shed blood over those differences. Now, for those of us who've grown up in America, those of us who value religious freedom, that can be a little hard for us to understand. How can you be that dedicated to your version of the rules that you're willing to shed blood over it? Our motto tends to be, believe whatever you want to believe, just don't impose your beliefs on me. Am I correct about that? Is that kind of how we feel about things, generally speaking? I think that our religious freedom is more important to us than the religion itself. And I would say that for the vast majority of us in churches, we probably feel more tied to our national identity than we do to our religious identity. I would say that most of us would probably be far more likely to shed blood for our country than we would for our religion. But here's something you have to realize, is that for the vast majority of religious people around the world, the exact opposite is true. They would be willing to do anything to defend their religion, because their religion is their life. And when somebody compromises their core religious values, well, in the same way that you're willing to defend your country, they're willing to defend their faith. The reason why I'm telling you all this is because when we read about people in the Bible, I think often we confuse these people with us, because these people are not us. These people are very different from us. These people don't do church for 1 hour on Sunday morning. These are people for whom their religion is everything. There is nothing more important in their life than living the way God wants them to live. And so this little scene today that we read from Mark, where Jesus is debating about the law, you have to realize that for those types of people, this is not just a debate, right? An argument that you can have and walk away. These debates have huge implications, because how you come down on a law, well, that can determine whether or not you're serving God in the right way. So, last 2 weeks, we've been talking about Mark chapter 2. And in Mark chapter 2, what we're presented with, it's no longer this narrative string, it's this series of stories or little scenes like vignettes where we're introduced to Jesus' interpretation of the law. It can be pretty boring, I'll admit to you. But what he tries to do, Mark, is he attempts to take Jesus' interpretation of the law and contrast that with the Pharisees. Now, how many people in here have heard that word Pharisee before? Raise your hand. How many of you in here know what that word means? Okay, when I was sitting where you were sitting, I must have heard that word 100 times when I was in church. Had no clue what it meant. And since we're going to be talking a lot about the Pharisees, I want to take some time today to tell you about who these people are, because if you don't know who they are, then it's going to be very, very challenging for you to understand what's happening with Jesus as we get into the gospel. So are we ready to talk a little bit about the Pharisees? All right. So the Pharisees, they were a sect of Judaism. Now, a sect is kind of like a denomination in Christianity. So we're Presbyterian, right? But there's other ones. There's Methodists, Lutherans, Episcopals, Baptists. Not that you want to be any of those people. You want to be Presbyterian. You're not allowed to leave. So, they're all Christian, but they have slightly different takes on what it means to interpret the scriptures, right? So the Pharisees, it's kind of the same thing. They're a version of Judaism. And during the first century, there were lots of different kinds of sects. There was the Pharisees, but there's also the Sadducees, the Essenes, the Zealots, and a bunch of other smaller sects. The reason why Mark chooses to contrast Jesus' interpretation with that of the Pharisees is because at the time Mark was writing his gospel, the Pharisees were becoming the dominant form of Judaism. Now, do you all remember when I told you Mark wrote his gospel? Who remembers the date? Anybody remember? 70 AD, very good, okay. Okay, 70 AD. Now, that year is important not just because Mark wrote his gospel. It's important for a much, much larger reason. That was the year that the Roman army came into Jerusalem and decimated the temple. Now, the temple was the place where Jewish people worshiped God. And so when they came in, 70 AD, they knocked the whole thing down. There is still one wall of that temple that is still remaining to this day. It is called the Wailing Wall. And if you go to Israel, you can still see it. People go there to pray all the time. And I highly recommend that if you do get the chance to go over, to go see it. So we're going to talk a lot about this event of the temple being destroyed in the future. But for now, what you need to know is when the temple was destroyed, there was no centralized place for people to worship God. It's kind of like if you were Catholic and the Vatican was destroyed, right? There's no centralized place anymore. So when that happened, well, the Jews, they had to figure out kind of a different way to deal with things. And in the countryside, away from the big city of Jerusalem, there were all these synagogues. Now, what's a synagogue? A synagogue is kind of like our church, right? So you have the Vatican, and then you have all these other little churches around. So, of course, they're going to go out, because they can't worship at the temple anymore, and worship in the synagogues. Interestingly, though, all these other sects of Judaism, except for the Pharisees, were very tied to the temple. And so when the temple was destroyed, what happened to their movements? Well, they were destroyed as well. They kind of disintegrated. But the Pharisees, they had a different take on things. They were out in the synagogues already. They'd been there for years, and they had been teaching the commoners in those synagogues. So the temple gets destroyed. The people go to the synagogues, and who do they find? Who's there? The Pharisees. And it's why the Pharisees become the dominant form of Judaism. Now, what set the Pharisees apart from everyone else? Well, this is an interesting question. So, of course, in the same way that what sets us apart is the way we interpret the Bible, it's the way they dealt with the Old Testament. Now, in the first five books of the Old Testament, how many laws are there? Do y'all remember? 613. Yeah, not bad, not bad. I wouldn't give you full credit on that one, but you got the 600, right? Okay, so 613. What made them different from everyone else is the way they tried to adhere to these 613 different commandments. And the way they ensured that they wouldn't break them, because that was really their thing, was they created these things called gezeras. Gezeras. So a gezera, what that literally means is preventative legislation. So a gezera is a law that helps prevent you from breaking the law. Do you see what I'm saying? Okay, if you don't understand it, don't worry. I'm going to make it very clear in a second. Okay, so one of the laws in the Old Testament is that you should observe the Sabbath. So you work for 6 days and you rest on the seventh day, which is Saturday. Very good. Okay, we've only been over that one 30 times. We're getting it, though. We're getting it. So It's Saturday. If you read Exodus 31:14, it says that if you work on the Sabbath, that you should be put to death. Now, I know that's a little harsh, but they took it very seriously. So just remember, when you're at home and you're watching football on Sunday, on your Sabbath day, you're doing exactly what God wants you to do, okay? Exactly. So, Sabbath day, you have to rest. And the Pharisees, they were really concerned about not breaking that law. So they created gezeras around the law. So these gezeras would say things like this. If you're talking about Jesus' time, you need to eat and you need to drink, right? So they would say, okay, if you have a well outside of your house, you can take 40 paces to go to your well. But if you go more than 40 paces, well, that's considered work. So they would put these things in place to prevent you from breaking law. In a sense, it's kind of like a fence around the law. And so the idea is, if you follow the gezira, if you follow the fence, if you mind it and you stay back from it, then that's going to prevent you from breaking the law, which is in the center. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay. In these gezeras, the way they worked is they got into minutiae that's like really hard to even believe, but they cover everything in your life, every detail that you deal with. So modern Jews today, they have gezeras that say things like, on the Sabbath, you're not allowed to flip on a light switch, right? Because that is considered to be work. I lived next door back when I was in Harrisburg to an Orthodox Jewish rabbi, and his wife ran over one day, and she said, I left the light on, can you turn it off for me? So Courtney had to walk over there and turn the light off because that's work. I wonder if it was more work for her to technically come over and ask Courtney to do that, but that's the way that she thought about it. You're also not allowed to operate machinery, which means that you can't drive a car on the Sabbath because that is considered work. So all these things, like, it can seem kind of crazy to us, right? Like, who would want to live with that kind of burden? But what you have to realize is that for the Jewish people and for the Pharisees, this isn't a burden at all. God handed them, was kind enough to hand you a roadmap, a manual to tell you exactly how you're supposed to live. And so by following those laws, they believe that they're honoring God. And this brings us back to what's happening in Mark's text. So in Mark's text, remember, Jesus, he's out there and he's picking grain on the Sabbath. Okay, he could have planned like everyone else and made sure he had a meal for the day, but instead he's out there picking grain. And the Pharisees, they see him doing this. And so they approach him and they say, hey, what are you doing? You're supposed to be resting on the Sabbath. Now, what should happen to Jesus according to Exodus 31:14? Should be put to death, right? Okay, so we know this is the scene, this is the setup. But there's a couple different problems with this scene. The first problem with it, if you really start to take a look at it, is the fact that these Pharisees, they really care about not breaking the Sabbath law, right? So why are they out in the middle of a field looking at Jesus and telling him that he shouldn't be breaking the Sabbath? Shouldn't they be at home resting? Or shouldn't they be in the synagogue, right, worshiping God? Of course they should. And that's exactly what they would have been doing. And that's how you know that this scene is totally fabricated by Mark, because you would never find a Pharisee in a wheat field on the Sabbath. Wouldn't happen. So that's the first sign you know that this scene is made up. The second sign that you know that this scene is made up is because everything that Jesus quotes from the Old Testament is totally wrong. Now, what happens is the Pharisees, they come out, they see Jesus, and then Jesus quotes some scripture at them. And so this is what he says. He says, have you not read what it says when David and his companions were hungry and in need of food? David entered into the house of God when Abiathar was high priest and took the bread of presence, which it is only lawful for the priest to eat, and gave some to his companions. Now that verse, it comes from 1 Samuel 21, 1-6. But everything about this is totally wrong. First of all, the high priest, his name is not Abiathar, I don't know who that is, but it's Ahimelech, I still don't know who that guy is, but the names are totally wrong. The second thing is that David doesn't enter into the temple, the priest just hands him the bread and says, here you go. And the third and most important thing about this is that it doesn't even take place on the Sabbath. So this has nothing to do with anything that they're talking about. So the question is, if all the details are wrong, why is this here? Because there's one of two things that happened here. Either Jesus really doesn't know his Old Testament very well, or Mark doesn't know his Old Testament very well. I think I'm going to go with option two. I don't know about you. So it is very clear that Mark had heard this story at some point in time. Maybe he'd read it, but he couldn't remember the details. And so he wrote it down the best that he knew when he inserted it into Jesus' mouth. But here's some of the issue with this, right? He didn't realize that people like us would be reading it 2,000 years later. And we could go back and we could actually check 1 Samuel 21, 1-6 to see if he was right. I think if he had known that, he probably would have fact-checked it a little better than he did. And secondly, the people who he was writing for, these people never really read the Old Testament. So they weren't going to know any different. They would have read that and said, oh, okay, and then moved on with it. So why, if the details are wrong, this scene obviously didn't happen, why is it in the Scripture? Why is it in Mark's Gospel? Well, I think it's here for a very specific reason. I think that Mark included this in his Scripture, in his Gospel. He included it in the Gospel because he wanted to illustrate something important about Jesus' movement. Jesus and his followers, they did not pay very much heed to this fence that the Pharisees had placed around the law. I know they should have paid more attention to it. I agree with you completely. The baptism only held for a little while. Sometimes, you know, the seal, it breaks quickly sometimes. She's like, you're preaching far too long. You need to close it, get it done, get it over with. So, I'll just backtrack on that for a second. So Jesus, he didn't pay much mind to the fence that these Pharisees had constructed around the law. Now, don't get me wrong, Jesus, he really wanted to follow and observe the Sabbath. He just wasn't concerned with all these extra rules that they had put up. So for Jesus, it's very important that you understand, Jesus believes it's important to follow God's law. He just doesn't think that the human interpretation of those laws is always beneficial. The Sabbath was made so you could rest. Everything else is just details. That's kind of Jesus' perspective. But those details, you have to realize, they really do matter. Because as much as we might want to look at the Pharisees and say, you guys are crazy for creating all these rules, from their perspective, those details really do count. And you can't just dismiss their way of thinking as something that is an ancient way of thinking and saying, oh, people don't think that way anymore. Do you realize that the only sect of Judaism that made it out of the first century are the Pharisees? So whenever, who has Jewish friends in here? Anybody have any Jewish friends? All of those people who you know who are Jewish, they are descendants of the Pharisees. So to sit there and to say that, oh, they have it all wrong, you can't really do that. Because ultimately, the modern Jewish people, this is why they are so obsessed with those details. It's why they're so concerned with minding the fence. But Jesus taught us to honor God in a slightly different way. Jesus, he taught us that we should walk past the fence. He taught us to not be so concerned with the details. He taught us that it's the spirit of the law that matters far more than the law itself. Now, there's a plus side and there's a downside to this way of thinking. The plus side, well, let's start with the minus side. The minus side is that when you open the fence, it's a lot easier to break the rules. Would you agree with that? I don't know very many Christians who are particularly good at observing the Sabbath, particularly the way it was intended to be observed. But the plus side is that when you open the fence, it means that there's a lot more opportunity for people to be part of God's family. Now, I don't profess to know which way is better. And I don't know which way is more right in God's eyes, but all I know is that our way, the Christian way, well, we welcome all people. And that means a lot to me as a guy who was never very good at following the rules. So today, as we come to this table, I want you to remember how Jesus opened the fence. I want you to know that following the Sabbath is important, but he also wants you to understand that there's more to God than simply following the right rules. Jesus wants us to have an experience. Jesus wants us to cross the fence, not so that we can just have a little taste of bread and a sip of juice, but so that we can have a true relationship with God. And so today, as you come forward to take communion, I hope you will remember how Jesus broke the rules so that you could be part of God's family. Amen.